you. It's a great pleasure to be back in Princeton. And it's indeed an honor to speak at this forum in front of this distinguished audience. So my title is Black Hole Degeneracies from Worldsheet Instantons. And I have a subtitle, From Macroscopics to Microscopics in String Theory. So before I begin, I would like to say that I feel very privileged to have been a Nati student. I learned a lot of physics from you and also ways of doing physics to organize until you finally see some kind of clarity. So I'm indeed very grateful for everything I've learned. You've taught me a lot, perhaps a little more than you think. Thank you very much. So two lessons that actually have stayed with me. The first one, and this is, I think this will be shared by many people who work with Nati. The first one is when Nati says, that had to be correct. So the first time this happened to me, he set me on some problem, and I spent 3 weeks calculating some theta function, proving some theta function identity. I was very happy to have done that, went to Nati and said, look, I think I've proved it. And he said, good, but that had to be correct. So this taught me that perhaps what's most important is not so much the fact that I could prove something, but really the intrinsic truth value of things and how they fit into the bigger picture. The second lesson is when Nati says, that cannot be correct. So of course, I got a lot more of lesson two than lesson one. It was of course very frustrating, but then with a little more maturity, I realized that actually this is just a mirror image of lesson one. And in fact, over the years, I've really begun to crave this kind of clarity of thought. Even today when I am confused about something, I ask myself, if I were to explain this to Nati, and then automatically a lot of things start falling into place. So, oh yeah, so I had actually many other stories, but if you were there in the first day or yesterday's dinner, Nati already has said that all those stories cannot be correct, so I think I should just move on to some physics. Okay, so let me first explain my subtitle, From Macroscopics to Microscopics. So the idea is that we want to probe the UV structure of our fundamental theory. And in order to do that, you consider some kind of low energy effective Lagrangian. So this is of the massless string modes obtained by integrating out all the massive string modes. So this is some formal object. It's an infinite derivative expansion. But it's sensitive to the UV theory. So if you think of string compactifications to four dimensions, it knows about all the details of the Calabi-Yau manifold. Okay, so you can use this Lagrangian to probe the UV theory. Now, in particular, if you have any microscopic symmetries acting on the fundamental theories, those symmetries impose constraints on the low energy effective action. Okay, so that is something which we all like very much. Now, this actually is the introduction to a very beautiful paper, and as many of you may have guessed in the audience from the font, it's from very long ago. It's clearly not mine, and at least two people in the audience should have recognized it. And what I find quite remarkable is the relevance of this even today. So this really serves as the philosophical introduction to my talk and indeed much of my work in the last few years. So things have changed, of course, in the last 29 years. So today I'll be talking about this low energy effective Lagrangian, not in flat space like here, but in the near horizon geometry of a black hole. And secondly, and perhaps more intriguingly, I'll talk of a situation where it's not clear how the microscopic symmetries, so the symmetry I'm talking about is the modular symmetries of string theory acting on black hole microstates, and I'll explain this. But it's not very clear from the low energy point of view how this symmetry acts. So that probably means that there's much more to be done. Okay, so the context I mean is the following. So we all know that this is very beautiful. Two pictures of black holes in string theory. So one is the macroscopic picture. So here's a black hole. It's a solution of effective Lagrangian. Today it'll only be in four dimensions. N here denotes some generic set of quantum numbers of the black hole, which encodes the size. Okay, so if you measure the thermodynamic entropy, it's equal to pi. So I've taken an example where there's only one N, and this thermodynamic entropy is pi times square root of n. Now, there's a parameter in string theory, as we all know, called g-string, which when it's large compared to 1 over n, you have the macroscopic picture. But when it's small compared to 1 over n, the Schwarzschild radius becomes smaller than the Compton wavelength. And the correct picture is this ensemble of microscopic excitations of the fundamental theory, so strings and brains and momenta and so on. Now here, you can just count how many, so both of them have the same quantum numbers, and you can just count how many states there are as a function of n. And this was what was done first in this pioneering paper by Strom and Jamafa. And then, so also today I'll be talking about supersymmetric situations. So I'm very happy this is Nutty Fest. I don't have to apologize for this fact. Usually when I give talks about black holes, I always have to explain why I'm thinking about supersymmetry. So today I won't do that. So one expects that if you count the right thing, some supersymmetric index, then that's invariant under continuous deformations. And indeed, it was found that this statistical entropy is equal to the thermodynamic entropy in the thermodynamic limit, namely n goes to infinity. Okay? So it's a very beautiful equation. It's one of the big successes of string theory. But clearly, this is an approximate equation. And the left-hand side, so when I say that, the left-hand side is not approximate. Given some supersymmetric system, with some charges, it's a completely well-defined problem to ask, what is the degeneracy of microstates? How many states there are? This is an intrinsic quantum property of the system. It's the dimension of some Hilbert space. That's what I call d micro. So the real question is about the right-hand side. It's about the gravitational theory. So the question is there something called quantum entropy, which is defined at finite n, which reduces to the Bekenstein-Hawking area law as n goes to infinity? Now, although d micro is in principle well-defined for supersymmetric situations, in practice, when you have a lot of supersymmetry, it's fairly easy to compute, but not true in generic, let's say, Calabi-Yau compactifications. Okay? So that's some problem which remains to be solved. So the hope, of course, is that if one develops this kind of methods, the gravitational methods, perhaps one can say something, get some kind of valuable information about the generic situation. All right. Now, so let's begin with an example where one does know everything very cleanly. So this is the this is type 2 string theory on a 6 torus, 32 superchargers. There's a huge U-duality group, and there's one quartic invariant of the charges. So there are 28 electric and 28 magnetic fields in some frame. So n is this quartic invariant. And in this theory, one knows black hole solutions which preserve 4 superchargers. And indeed, the area of this black hole, all the physics must be only governed by n because of duality. And indeed, the area of the black hole is 4 pi square root of n. So this was the example I was just talking about. The microscopics is also well understood. So one good thing about this, giving a talk with this audience, is most of my references are actually here. So if you have any questions, I can just ask them to answer. So here is the answer. So the microscopic degeneracy of states, you write a generating function. So these are actually 2 generating functions, but they're really one because this is some even and odd, and you can combine them into one function if you want. And these generating functions are just ratios of simple elementary theta and eta functions, which we all know what they are. Okay, so the way to read this, so then you do a Fourier expansion. The way to read this is the power of q, so 1, 2, 3, 4, no, times 4 or something, is the charge n, and the Fourier coefficient, 2, 12, 56, et cetera, that's the degeneracy of microstates. Okay, that's the number of states that you're interested in. Now, if you think about a black hole, then a black hole is weakly curved when n is very large. So the natural question you want to ask is what is the growth of the Fourier coefficients asymptotically? Okay? Now, this question has been studied a lot by mathematicians. For functions like this, and the reason is that these functions are not annual functions, they're what are called modular forms. What that means is that if you write q as e to the 2 pi at tau, tau being in the upper half plane, these functions at tau are related to the function at tau plus 1, and more importantly, at minus 1 over tau. This fact is extremely constraining, and they're holomorphic. This fact is extremely constraining. In fact, in this example, it's so constraining that you can actually invert this equation exactly. Usually, we do some saddle point analysis. So here's the answer. So that's d micro of n for this situation I just showed you. It's written as an infinite series. This is a convergent exact series. So in fact, a little bit of history. So this was first developed by Hardy and Ramanujan almost 100 years ago. So they were looking for analytic estimates for these integers. And they had a very good analytic estimate. And sometime in the 60s, Hans Rademacher was giving a lecture about this Hardy-Ramanujan method, and he realized that you could just kind of repackage the error terms so as to get a convergent expansion. The main idea is if you want to estimate an integer and analytically, and you get an error less than half, that's an exact formula. Okay. So that's what it is. So what is it? It's an infinite sum over something called C, which is positive integer, some polynomial prefactor. This is called a closed Terman sum, and I won't discuss this today. It's a sum over phases. It's important, but it doesn't carry entropy. And then you have this Bessel function with some prefactors, which I've defined here, of argument pi square root of n over c. Now, if you remember, the I Bessel function at large values of argument goes as an exponential. Therefore, c equal to 2 and higher are exponentially suppressed. So the leading or the main term, as analytic number theorists call it, is just this one Bessel function. And then you can do an asymptotic expansion of this Bessel function. Okay. Now, one thing to note, so it's a little funny. You might think that the right-hand side is completely determined. This is some non-trivial function. But you might say, everything is kind of just given to you. But that's not quite true. This number 7/2 is something that comes out of the problem. And that's because it's a technical thing, but it's because you have theta to the 1 times theta to the 6, and then you have to ask how these things transform under modular transformation. And then there is one other piece of data that enters this formula, and in fact, that's a 1 which is sitting out of the sum, so you don't see it. And that 1 is this 1 over here. Okay? So the way this formula works is that the only things that contribute to the formula are the transformation properties themselves. Those are very simple. And the powers of q, which are negative. So those are the ones that grow at the cusp q equal to 0. Okay? So in this case, there's only one. So later, there's going to be more. But there's always only a finite number. OK, so now we want to interpret this in physics. And to do that, we need to understand what is meant by quantum entropy. And this was taught to us by Ashok Sen some years ago. The idea is to look near horizon. You always have, because you have a supersymmetric black hole, you always have a two-dimensional anti-de Sitter factor. So in four dimensions, you always have ADS2 times S2. That's Euclidean ADS2. And on this geometry, you're supposed to do a path integral of your full gravitational theory. So it's, again, it's a formal object. The boundary conditions are fixed by the classical attractor mechanism. So everything is fixed by the charges of the black hole. And in the interior, all the graviton and all the other fields fluctuate. And you're supposed to do this path integral. It's a one-point function of this Wilson line. It's an expectation value. Okay? So there's some renormalization and regularization. So all this has been worked out. And this is set up in such a way such that if you do a saddle point, you'll get back the classical walled entropy. And now we're supposed to do quantum fluctuations around this. So this geometry, by the way, is maximally supersymmetric. So in four dimensions, this has 8 supercharges. And in particular, I'll be using one supercharge which squares to L0 minus J0, which is some compact U1 generator. So this was very brief, but basically the story is that, so this is the same formula that I showed you 2 slides ago, that this whole formula can be interpreted exactly as the exponential of the quantum entropy. Okay, so the way it's easy to begin from this side. So this one here is pi square root of n, which is the Bekenstein-Hawking entropy. The next term is this minus 15 over 4 log n. That's the one loop correction, leading logarithmic one loop correction around this classical ADS 2 times S2 geometry, and so on. Now, what is a little bit of a surprise is that, in fact, you can understand this full leading Bessel function as an all-order perturbation theory result using supersymmetric localization. So this is something we developed in a series of papers with Atish Dabholkar and João Gomes, and I'll tell you a little bit about it. Again, this being a fest for Nati, I couldn't resist the temptation to make a table Many of you might have seen this before, but it's nice. Oh, yeah, so in fact, in this last paper, one could also, we showed how one can also interpret these exponentially damped corrections as coming from orbifolds of ADS2. Okay. So here's the table. I'll be very quick. So this is N, which is the size of the black hole. This is the microscopic degeneracy of states. These are the numbers you saw, 8, 12, 39, and so on. The last column is the exponential of the classical entropy. So that's just area over 4. And if you go to n equal infinity, you'll see that these two columns asymptotically agree. That's the Strom-Minkowski result. And now here you see this exponential of the quantum entropy. And you see, so firstly, that the quantum corrections, even numerically, can be quite large. And then you see that these things, you see how, at least for small n, or even for small n, you see by looking at this calculation in the continuum theory, you can practically read off what the microscopic integer is. Okay? So the correct statement is that these two, as I said, are exponentially close. Okay. Now, what we want to do is to go beyond this prototype and ask what happens in more general situations. So just to summarize what happened in the n equal to 8 theory, we want to compute quantum effects in gravity. The input is the Wilsonian effective action of the light modes of string theory. And what we do is compute the functional integral over these light modes using this, this quite powerful technique. Now, this prototype theory has one very simplifying feature in that if you write this as in the n equal to 2 language, then you can think of F terms and D terms. So full superspace integrals and holomorphic chiral superspace integrals, the F term is tree-level exact. This is because type 2 on a torus, the torus has, 6 torus has many fermion zero modes, so that just kills all the loop contributions. Okay? So the natural question is what happens in lower supersymmetry? So in particular, there are stringy effects, so these are Worldsheet instantons which wrap various cycles in your compactification manifold, which contribute to this effective action. And the question is, how do these instantons encode the black hole degeneracies? So that's the macroscopic side of the story. The microscopic side of the story is also subtle beyond this prototype. And the reason is the following. So let's go to the next simplest example, which is type 2 on K3 times T2. So this is 16 superchargers. So the partition function is known here. So in this case, states, BPS states with 4 superchargers are labeled by 3 integers. So the duality group is smaller, and these are the 3 t-duality invariants of this theory. So you have this partition function, which is 1 over a certain function, which is called the Igusa-Kuss form, it's a well-known function. And this was first kind of written down by Dijkgraaf and Verlinde and Verlinde, and then more recently it was proven. So we know what the partition function is, but there's a problem, which is that this equal sign is not really correct. So there's, this function has zeros, or more precisely divisors, and therefore this function is meromorphic. The inverse of this function is meromorphic. And so there's no sense. One needs more definition for a Fourier expansion. Okay? You need to say where, how, in what order you're doing the Fourier expansion. Okay? So what's the physics of this? The physics of this is that in this theory, to the supersymmetric index that is being computed, unlike in n equal to 8, apart from the single center black hole, there are also other gravitational configurations which contribute to this index. And in this case, the only other contributions that contribute are 2 center black holes, which are each half BPS. Okay? But these are there. They have very little entropy, but they're there. And these move when you move in the moduli space of the scalar fields at infinity. Okay? So you want to remove these. So that's the reason why there's an ambiguity in the Fourier expansion. And you want to remove these things, because we're only interested in the black hole. But that means that you're throwing away part of the spectrum of the theory, and so you break your symmetries, and in particular, the modular symmetry. Okay? So all this nice formalism that I gave you seems to break down. But actually, this problem can be solved for this theory. And the way to solve it is the following. So first, you go to a limit where sigma goes to I infinity. That's an unambiguous expansion. You get this bunch of functions called psi m, which are, because this has some automorphic properties, this also has a Jacobi property. Jacobi essentially means there's a modular property and one more property under which You can shift z by integer multiples of 1 and tau. But this inherits the meromorphy of this function. So physically what this means is that you're just fixing the magnetic charge. That's what m means. And letting the electric charge fluctuate. Okay, so that's q square and q dot p. Now, in such a situation, so what we understood with Atish Dabhalkar and Don Zagier, a number theorist, is that there's a way to canonically decompose such meromorphic functions into two functions. In this context, what it means is that one of the functions contains all the multicentered information. So you can just, both these functions have some properties. You do it this way. So what you're left with is the single-centered black hole, the partition function of that. So you've broken modular symmetry, and the theorem is that this is what is called a mock Jacobi form. So I don't have time to explain what that really means, but essentially what it means is that this function itself is not quite modular, but one can add a specific non-holomorphic function called the shadow function, such that the sum is modular at the expense of holomorphy. Okay? So these things were first discovered by Ramanujan a long time ago, and only recently, relatively recently, Sanders Vegers gave a theory of these functions, and then there's been an explosion in mathematics of this field. But the main point for us today is that you can resurrect the power of modularity. Okay? So in particular, that means that there is a Rademacher-type formula for these Mach-Jacobi forms, but with some modifications. Okay? And this has been worked out in a lot of detail by Katrin Brinkmann and Ken Ono and many other people. So here is, I'll just show you one sample formula. It's more complicated. I don't need you to understand all the details. The main point, so Cm is the Fourier coefficient of psi m, is that it's, again, a sum of Bessel function, a finite, it's a sum of Bessel functions. This is a finite sum. So this is some index of the Bessel function. Everything is determined. This is some elementary function. The only input are the Fourier coefficients Cm, in the regime where 4mn minus l square is negative. So this is the equivalent of this q inverse, the thing that blows up. Okay? So there are a finite number of these that go in. Here I've put an approximation because this is kind of the c equal to 1 analog of what I showed you, and then there's a whole subleading saddle points and infinite sequence. Okay? But today I'll focus on this. Okay, so the natural question here now is on the microscopic side. So the fact that the black hole generically breaks the modular symmetry, how does gravity see it? And in particular, in the n equal to 4 situation, does gravity, and how, if so how, see the Mach modular symmetry? Okay, so these are the two questions that I would like to sketch an answer towards in this talk. So just to give you a sense of where we're going, at the end of this talk, I'll present a formula, which is still in progress. In the context of compactification on K3 times T2, there's a very simple relation between the degeneracies of worldsheet instantons on this manifold and the degeneracies of single-centered black holes. Okay? So worldsheet instantons, this is a very easy problem. This was solved many years ago in string theory. This is a complicated problem, which I just talked about. And there's a very simple relation between these two. It's a quadratic relation. This should remind you of the formula of Ogury, Strom, and Jernbaffa. And then f and more, but I hope to convince you that there's something new, and in this context, something much simpler. So this is based on work that I did with my student, Valentin Reis. He's actually just graduated. And then and the work of many, many other people, many of whom are in the audience. So, very good. So any questions so far? All right. So then let me tell you how to do this computation. So what do we want to do? What you want to do is to solve this gravitational functional integral on this ADS2 times S2. So just write this really as a old-fashioned, like just a very literal functional integral. So integral over the space of fields with this Wilson line operator times e to the minus s. This s is the effective action I've talked about from the first slide. So it's an infinite derivative formal object. So of course, there's some amount of guesswork which goes on. It's a gravitational functional integral. It's not even well defined. But what we did was to try to use this trick of localization, which says that any such functional integral, if you have some supercharge with squares to a compact U1 generator, it reduces enormously to the, from the infinite dimensional field space of supergravity to the space of BPS solutions in the off-shell theory. Okay, you need it to be off-shell because going from here to here, you have to do some manipulations inside the functional integral using the algebra, and you want the algebra to hold. And then there's some induced measure, the same operator, the same action, and there's a one-loop fluctuation determinant of a certain deformation term that you have to add. So I'm not giving you details, because many of you know it, but I can talk about it after the talk. So that's what you want to do. So you want to do this in supergravity. So the first thing you want is a formalism where you have such off-shell supersymmetry. So this was actually, the one we use is four-dimensional n equal to 2 supergravity coupled to some number of vector multiplets. So this is probably the best formalism for this problem. This was developed in the 80s. So having more supersymmetry is a technical problem here. People don't know how to do this off-shell and so on. In this formalism, one has to find all solutions of these localization equations, cube psi equal to zero, with Euclidean radius 2 times S2 boundary conditions. So this we did in this first paper with Dabolkar and Gomsch, and then so in this first paper we understood the vector multiplet. So the good thing about the off-shell formulation is that you can analyze it multiplet by multiplet. There's no mixing because there's an off-shell completion. So here we solve the vector multiplet, and in this paper with Rajesh Gupta we solve the Weyl multiplet, and the answer is that for every vector multiplet and for the graviton multiplet, there's one degree of freedom which is allowed to go off-shell. So there's nv plus one parameters of the localization manifold, and this can be parametrized by a certain scalar field. This is the scalar field in the vector multiplet, n equal to 2 vector multiplet, which goes off-shell like this. So at the boundary, it's fixed by the charges. That's the attractor value, and then there's a certain shape which is fixed by supersymmetry, supported by the auxiliary fields. And the size is arbitrary, and you have to integrate over the size. Okay, so those are the parameters. Then on this localization manifold, you have to evaluate the full supergravity action. Now, the full supergravity action has F terms and D terms. The F terms all of us like. This is something which is controllable. There's lots of ways to evaluate it. Thank you. So this is what you find from the topological string, for instance. The D terms are harder. In fact, the D terms in supergravity are not even classified. There's a lot which is known, but there's no full classification. But luckily, what we could show was that any D term that we know about does not contribute. Okay, so there's some kind of non-renormalization. So, and the last step is to compute the determinant and measure. This is an interesting subject by itself, and I won't discuss this today. So there's a lot of work, and plus some ongoing work, which I hope to report on this in a few months. This is very interesting. So at the end of the day, you get this simple formula, which is the entropy of a black hole carrying some charges Q and P. It's an n plus one dimensional integral of the exponential of the Legendre transform of the imaginary part of the prepotential of the supergravity theory. Okay, so this F is, again, it's not just the leading F, it's the full expansion to all orders. Okay. So that's the thing. And then if you write this, if you use this for the n equal to 8 theory where the F term is exact, so it's a cubic prepotential, you find, so there's some truncation which you can later justify. You find that there's some 8-dimensional integral, 7 of which turn out to be Gaussian. This is some intersection matrix of the torus. And then you're left with one integral, which is precisely the integral representation of the Bessel function, which is what I showed you many slides ago. Okay, so this is the n equal to 8. This is how it works in n equal to 8. And now you want to go to this K3 times T2 example, where, so this is the leading, it's a classical prepotential, and then there are instanton corrections. For K3 times T2, this F is one loop exact, so this is the exact prepotential. And it's known what it is. It's a very simple function. It's log of eta to the 24. And this, you can expand this function e to the minus f. And these numbers are well known. And this is what I call the instanton degeneracies. So now I want to take this prepotential and put it back in our formula. And if you remember the formula, so here, if you have a cubic prepotential, you get one Bessel function. Now, if you think of this as a series, then each of them actually just shifts the quadratic part a little bit, so you get an infinite set of Bessel functions. Okay? And if you look at that carefully, you'll see that the argument of the Bessel function decreases up to a certain number, and then starts increasing and goes away to infinity. So there's something clearly wrong about this. It's divergent, and that actually means that you need a contour to fix this. So in fact, it turns out that the ones that work are exactly the right ones, and a good contour was found in this paper. So we use that, and here is the formula that we get from gravity. Okay, so this is the kind of leading term of the quantum entropy. This is this paper with Valentin. So you get this sum over Bessel functions with some input which comes from the instanton degeneracies. Okay. And now you can compare the microscopic and macroscopic formulas. And they look exactly the same. This is the leading term again. It's a finite number of Bessel functions. Everything one could reproduce from gravity. The only difference is that here in gravity you get this instanton degeneracies. And in the microscopic theory, these are the polar degeneracies of these Mach Jacobi forms of the black hole. So the natural conjecture which you made is that these two are equal, right? That these two are equal. So that's the conjecture in our paper, and it's a very clean, simple conjecture. So you could have thought everything I said until now, you could have taken just as inspiration and thought of this as an experimental formula. That's it. So D is the degeneracy of the function 1 over eta to the 24, the Fourier coefficient. Cm is the polar degeneracies of the single-centered black hole. It's a hard problem. There's a finite number of them, defined only when 4mn minus L squared is negative. These are the numbers which completely control the black hole degeneracies, exactly, not just to leading order. If I know all these numbers, then this Mach-Mandler technology tells you that I can compute the exact function. Okay? And this is the relation. Now, so there are some, as I said, this is still not an exact equality because there are corrections on both sides, which we have not computed yet, but we know how to compute it. Now, the thing is, the CM, one knows what they are, so one can actually check this formula. So in this work with Dabolko and Zagier and then another paper with Katrin Brinkmann, these functions have been worked out. So for each value of magnetic charge, you know what these functions are exactly in terms of some standard modular and Jacobi. So this is some Eisenstein series. This is theta square over eta to the 6. This is the generating function of something called Hurwitz-Kronecker class numbers. All these functions are completely well understood. And on the computer, I have a list up to, so this is m equal to 1, this is m equal to 2. So for each m, I can just tell you what this function is. So one can check this formula. And the last 2 minutes, I just want to show you, 5 minutes, I just want to show you how it works, the match. So this is m equal to 1. So there are 3 polar coefficients. And those are the values of C, 3, 48, and 600. I've drawn a horizontal line here, and also here, and in the rest of the checks, to show that I know that things below here do not work because I've neglected the subleading saddle points. So it's just a little complicated. I haven't done it. I know how to do this in principle. So you should not look here. And above this, these two match exactly, 348, 348. So this is in bold face. I don't know if you see it. And there's a reason for it later. Same thing here. So 5 polar terms, there's a perfect match, and so on and so on. You can just check this. At m equal to 3, you get a small discrepancy. And we went on, in the paper, we went up to m equal to 7. But at home, I did it for m equal to 10. These numbers become larger. And so let me just show you the last one. So m equal to 7, for instance. These are a non-trivial set of numbers. To compute this, it took us a lot of technology and understanding. These are the ones which control the black hole degeneracies. This is my simple formula. But you start seeing little discrepancies. Okay? So one type of discrepancy is because this contour that I talked about in gravity has something called edge effects, and we were not very careful about it. So there are little corrections to that. So this one needs to carefully compute. On this side is what is very interesting. The formula that I showed you for the microscopic degeneracy, what I presented to you, I just assumed that the thing is a true Jacobi form. But it's not. It's really a Mach Jacobi form. There are modifications. One knows in principle how to take into account these modifications. I didn't do it in this paper. But what is very easy to do is to estimate where those modifications lie. And it's precisely here that the Mach modular modifications lie. So what this is telling you is that the gravity, so this is the right answer, I think. So this is the wrong. So gravity knows about this Mach modular symmetry of the theory. Okay, so I think I'm out of time, more or less. Let me conclude. So the first lesson is that the degrees of freedom of a black hole are, at least for these supersymmetric situations, are encoded in a very intricate manner. So there's some quantization, but it's not happening by some brute force quantization. Gravity or string theory takes this integer and spreads it out into some very nice analytic formula, which you can start computing order by order in perturbation theory and then non-perturbative. Modular symmetry is very useful to decode this. The gravitational path integral seems to know about the Mach nature, which was not apparent from the effective action at all. Instantons in supergravity encode these black hole degeneracies via this explicit and simple relation. More work needs to be done because of these discrepancies, but we think we know how to do that. And finally, at a philosophical note, it should be clear by now that there are constraints on the low energy effective action. The constraint simply is that the low energy effective action should be such that you get an integer at the end. This is a very strong constraint. In my formulas, you could have seen this by just changing the parameters of the low energy effective action a little bit, it will go far from an integer. Okay, so there's clearly a constraint which can be also pushed to non-supersymmetric situations. I've not done this, but other people have done this. So thank you for your attention and happy birthday, Nazi.
Questions? Nadi?
It's not a question just for you, it's for all these people who do localization computations. When you have this integral d phi,
yes,
this exponent, what determines the measure in the integral?
So yeah, so I kind of avoided that. So at strings last year I talked about that, and let's see, where is it? Here. So let's go to the formula. Here it is. So there are two parts to the measure. One of them, so there's some infinite dimensional field space in which you have this localization manifold. So there's one induced measure just from the geometric part. Actually, that turns out to be a little bit of a difficult problem, but people have solved that. I mean, so technically that's not very easy, but you can try to solve that. Just you have to ask how the localization manifold is curved inside the thing. And then there is this one loop determinant, which is very important. That's part of my measure. Okay, so when I write its integral of d phi, it's part of the measure. Now, how much of this has been done? So some amount, so what has been done is the one loop determinant of all the matter fields around gravity. What has not been done is the one loop determinant of the gravitational field itself. That's something which is which we're doing. And one reason it's not intrinsically difficult. The main problem is some gauge fixing. You have to do gauge fixing in this covariant way, preserving this supersymmetry. But I think it can be done. And this is something I hope to talk, tell you about. So
is it also true for the formula in the integral d phi of e to the imaginary?
So here, so there is some measure here. So this measure turns out to be e to the, so these theories are defined by this holomorphic prepotential, which then induces something called a Kähler potential, which is close to the Kähler potential in field theory, but not exactly. There's one more parameter. So here, this, inside this is hiding an e to the minus Kähler function k, evaluated at this number. It's so the absolute value of that.
So the d phi there is
It's not a literal d phi. There's a measure here which we know what it is. And that has been used in the formulas that I told you. I didn't want to complicate that's a whole other story. Again, some of it we understand and some of it not.
So let me ask about the constraints that you discussed on low energy supergravity.
Yeah.
So could you give a more specific example of something you couldn't change or...
Yeah,
for example, you have this cubic superpotential. Can you change this?
No, so I think the coefficients you can't change. It's because you'll get. So those coefficients went into. Where is it? Even for this problem up here, there's a coefficient which went in here. Right. So if you look, if you look at my table of numbers, if I change these coefficients here, then these things will change. Right. There's a more general story, which is, did I answer your question?
Yeah. Okay. Well, presumably those coefficients are constrained by anomalies or...
Yeah, so at lowest order, but then what I'm saying now is that once you start, so this one is not so surprising. We know that this has to, but when you start including higher derivative corrections, those things are not very constrained. At least we don't know, at least practically we don't know how to fix them very easily. So that's a constraint. So another example is just even the leading log correction, for instance, which is only sensitive to the field content. That itself is a very big constraint, which can be computed very easily. So you say whatever your theory is must reproduce that coefficient of the log term.
Yeah, the instanton degeneracy coefficients,
yes.
Do they have a number theoretic interpretation that, like in some of the other mock moonshine or representation theoretic interpretation? Yeah. These numbers, right?
This representation theory, you can think of this as the Hilbert space of 24 bosons.
Yeah.
And that's the representation theory.
And the others also, you have some interpretation for
all of these, yeah. Like this whole thing comes out of
higher character degrees or things of this kind.
Yeah, you can you can understand this as a trace in a certain Hilbert space.
Yeah. Yeah. Last question.
I missed the argument of why the higher F terms can be neglected. You're only taking into account, it seems, the prepotential.
In right? This?
Yeah. What about all the higher F terms?
What do you mean, higher F terms?
Higher derivative terms, which are half superspace integrals.
So for type 2 theory, there are none.
Right. But in general, would they contribute?
Yes. That's my formula. I just here's the formula that I. So in general, this F is a full F. So for N equal to 8 theory, this is tree level exact. That gave you the first table that I showed you. For N equal to 4 theory, this is what I did with Valentin. It's one loop exact, so there's a more intricate relation. And in general, this is this is kind of the OSV idea, right? That this is the full F.
Okay.
But the D terms don't contribute.
Okay.
Okay, let's have further questions in private, and let's thank Samir again. And
thank you.
Shiraz as well.